Hey everyone, Ryan here, host of Going the Distance, the Rocky Series podcast. On the off chance that you're actually listening to this podcast episode because we are now starting to cover the Creed franchise, well, welcome. Welcome to the podcast. And I invite you to listen to the previous seasons where we covered Rockies 1 through 6. We are now entering the Creed franchise. I'm just starting a little bit of an audio plug here before we roll into episode 1 of Creed season 7 of Going the Distance, is because unfortunately for some odd and frustrating reason the recording quality wasn't very good on this episode. So I ask for your patience that you won't give up on this season just because this first episode, the recording audio, it was just terrible. Something happened with my computer software, and because of that, the video version that we released for our Patreons of the unedited video is not going to be released because there was no video. It was just a black screen. For whatever reason, the recording gods were against us during this first episode recording of season 7, episode 1. That's why the quality, audio quality, isn't that great. I suspect and hope that, of course, the further episodes, like episodes past, the recording quality will be pretty good. So again, patrons, that's why you didn't get a video. And for those who are interested, for as low as $1 a month, what you're helping to do as a patron is pay for the feed. If we had 40 people paying $1, that would pay for the feed. And I appreciate those who are patrons. And we've lost a couple this month. That's fine. We know times are tough. We want to thank you for your pledges of the past and hope you'll come back and help support the show. The perks that patrons do get is early releases of episodes and the video. And when I talk about the video, what you're getting is you're actually seeing me and Kyle talking to the movie. So there's scenes where we say, hey, this or hey, that. All that stuff is on the audio feed, but you get to see the scenes that we're talking about visually as well as audio. So it's a nice little perk. You do get the ums and ahs and things like that as well. It's all on unedited raw audio and video. But some people do enjoy it, and we thank those who do watch those. Lastly, you're going to hear in this recording that we announced that we're going to go down to one show every 2 weeks. The reason for this is I'm back at work, and I explained that. With the COVID over now, it's just not enough time for me to edit. Recording's not really an issue. It's actually editing. And you will say, well, Ryan, why do you edit? Well, I listen to some podcasts where they don't edit, and I'm not going to lie to you, it's sometimes frustrating. Maybe it's just me as a podcaster. Maybe it's only me. But if you heard the ums and ahs and the dead silence, or maybe us Googling something. So I try to produce a good quality show. I try to take out the pauses and dead silences, or dead air, they call it, jokes that don't land, things like that. You know, I want you guys to have a tight show, and I want you guys to have a good listening experience. Well, at least not a terrible one. So anyways, that takes a lot of time. And I also have another podcast called The Worst of the Best Podcast. Yeah, check that one out too. So basically, I host two podcasts, and doing two podcast recordings a week, two podcast editing a week, and now with me back at work, working 12, 14-hour days, it's just impossible for me to sustain that. And I also spend some time with my family, of course. So it's going to be Going the Distance 1 week, and then the following week will be Worst of the Best, and then the following week will be Going the Distance. So that's how it's going to go. Again, I want to thank everyone that supports the show on Twitter, supports the show on Facebook, sends us emails, and also a special thanks to those who are patrons to help pay for the feed and to throw a couple shekels my way for editing and all that good stuff. It really is appreciated. I do appreciate it. I really do. The fan base for this podcast is the best. You guys have been so kind to me over the years. I know this was a long preamble, but I just want to get that all out because the episode will now make more sense when you start to listen to it. So without further ado, here you go, Creed. Welcome everyone to Going the Distance, the Rocky Series podcast. This is season 7, episode 1. We are now entering the Creed franchise. With me today is my co-host, Kyle Peterson. Welcome, how are you this evening?
I'm hanging in there, brother. Doing pretty good. How are you doing?
I'm doing pretty good. I heard that you had a rough sleep last night. Is that right?
The way things go, yes. I did not sleep well. I've been dragging it all day. I'm just going to do this podcast and go to sleep.
Well, before we get rolling, I just want to say I am excited that we are covering the Creed franchise. I'm excited for Season 7, and I want to, again, say thank you to all of our listeners who joined us on the Season 6 Rocky Balboa coverage. We had a great time doing that. A little bit of an announcement here. Kyle said, Ryan, you don't need to give them a big explanation, and he's absolutely right. I asked my wife. I tend to ramble on sometimes. Maybe that's why I podcast. But long story short, I'm going back to work. The school, the training facility that I train in for new recruits here in the Canadian Forces, we're opening our doors again at the end of June, beginning of July. And what does that mean for Ryan? Well, it basically means my free time is going to be gone. And I don't want to stop the show, so we're just going to basically be releasing 2 episodes a month, vice or 4, or once a week. So we'll be doing bi-weekly releases. The good news is I think the episodes won't be rushed in some sense. You know, like when Kyle and I do sit down to record, it's not going to be like, oh, we were just here 5 to 7 days ago, and here we are recording for another hour. So maybe the episodes might be a little bit longer, or at the very least, they won't feel rushed. We can really delve into it. We won't be tired. Because as most of you know, if you haven't already, go check out my other podcast called Worst of the Best. That is the Worst of the Best podcast. And that one, too, will be every 2 weeks. So basically, it's going to be Going the Distance and then Worst of the Best and alternating between the two shows. Because I run 2 podcasts, but I'm only going to do 1 recording a week. So there you go. That's the update. Hope you'll still join us for the journey and can understand that time is valuable.
Well, I think that, you know, we don't want to be training in a house of ill repute. We want to be doing things right.
That's right. Yeah, we also don't want to burn ourselves out, keeping it fresh. In fact, it's been a couple of weeks since Kyle and I have recorded since our season finale, and I already feel kind of like rejuvenated. Already, we had a bit of a break. Other than Kyle's poor sleep last night, I think he probably feels rejuvenated. It's kind of a nice way to give ourselves a couple of weeks, record again, give ourselves a couple more weeks, and it kind of rejuvenates us. We want to say again thank you to our listeners, and thank you for our new patrons. And you guys have been amazing, and it's been fun talking to you guys on our Patreon page. I want to make sure I give this guy a shout-out. Mike Titsworth. So, Mike, thank you so much for being a new patron. We truly appreciate it. He's give us a new pledge. And also want to say thank you to Cameron Jackson for his generous pledge. A couple new patrons. What does it mean to be a patron? Well, it means you get an early release to our episodes. You also get to watch this incredibly terrible raw edit of Kyle and I doing the audio visual. We'll send you a link on YouTube where you can watch the raw unedited recording of these episodes, see what jokes don't make it, stuff like that. There's a few that don't. I tell you, every time I edit, I always say to people, they don't believe me. I know, because our audio edits are they're flawless, they're great.
But if you want to, jokes ain't so easy, Ryan.
No, telling jokes ain't easy. Some jokes don't land, Kyle. Some jokes.
Crime don't pay, Ryan. Crime don't pay.
And there's times that I see Kyle shaking his head at me when I tell a joke. I'm like, oof, maybe I should have told that one. And it doesn't make the air on the official feeds. But if you're a Patreon, you get to see all that stuff. So, and also what you're also doing is you're saying, hey, thanks, Ryan and Kyle, for your work, for your hundreds of hours of episodes and keeping the feed alive. And we appreciate it. We really do. So I sent everyone a message saying thank you. And I just want to read Cameron's response because it was really kind. So I thank Mike. I sent him a Patreon message. Cameron's response to my thank you was really kind. I wanted to read that out, and he didn't expect me to read this out, and I hope he doesn't mind. I said, hey, Cameron, thank you so much for your pledge and support of the show. It's very kind and humbling, Ryan. And he responded, cheers, Ryan. I've been enjoying the show for a while now. Still need to go back to listen to the first 2 films or 2 seasons. I hope your brother's doing good and been enjoying the show with Kyle. I've been hammering through the last few episodes, and you've been right about people who appreciate the show should show some appreciation. If I was in your shoes, some feedback, be it email, tweet, review, Patreon, or likes, or whatever, good or bad, would be great to hear to show appreciation. You guys put out regular quality content, so it's time for me to show that appreciation besides some of my tweets. Keep punching and going the distance. Ding, ding. Looking forward to the Creed and Ramble coverage. Cameron.
Thank you, Cameron. Appreciate that.
That's awesome. And that's Cameron. And I didn't even pay him to say that. He paid me to say that. No, I do appreciate that, Cameron. And it's nice to those who understand the system and how it works, what it's like to bring content to people's ears. If you think about 26 episodes a year, Kyle, that's actually an hour plus per episode. That's longer than a regular TV show of entertainment, like a season, a 22-episode season, a 45-minute show. So if you think about how much content this little podcast provides, it's we're on season 7 of a TV show. It's to me, it's crazy. I don't know.
We're basically the Big Bang Theory of Rocky themed broadcasts.
Yeah, we get worse with every season.
Oh.
Yeah, and we don't have a cute blonde in our corner either.
Not yet.
We did get some more emails here. Can't read this long one here, Brian Granko. It's a good one though. He just wanted to thank us for our show. He says we're doing a good job, and he's enjoyed our coverage of the Rocky films. He sent us more photos that we got to enjoy, but he did give us some interesting stuff here. He said, I heard you mention the lucky 7 bar in the Rocky Balboa fight part 1. That was that episode. He said the original bar had a fire, and it was torn down.
Yeah, that's right.
Okay. He said he read about it and also heard it mentioned in one of Mike Kunda's YouTube videos, and then he sent me 3 Google photos of that, so it was pretty cool. And he also said that you guys might notice my writing skills leave a little to be desired. Well, that's not true, Brian. Don't say that. I don't think I can compete with some of your other emailers like Greg the First. But I like to think I can get my point across. You do, Brian. And you provide great pictures. Let's be honest. Greg the First doesn't provide any pictures. He goes, I'm getting ready to listen to the second part of the fight episode. Maybe I'll hear something to comment with in another email. Keep up the good work, and I'm ready for Creed 1, which we're doing now, so bring it on. Once again, stay safe and keep punching, Brian. Thank you, Brian, and thank you again, Brian, for your pictures that you send of all the locations and stuff. We appreciate it. Just so you know, we haven't got any new reviews. Those are gold. Send us a review, guys, on iTunes. That'd be amazing. Hector, our favorite wrestler, he talks about concussions. In his last email to us, he mentioned that he himself has received concussions even before he was a wrestler. He said here that I was hit by a car when he was 5 years old. I was hit on the head with a rock, slipped off the basketball rim after a dunk and fell into concrete, ruptured 2 discs in my lower back in the process, got my brains beat in a fight with my father, all as a teen.
This guy takes Rocky levels of punishment.
No kidding. And Hector, man, like, I'm glad you're alive and you're with us right now. So he just mentions that concussions are a real thing and they stick around for a while. He just talks about all the different tests that he has regarding the concussions, but he's still able to return to the wrestling ring and he keeps fighting. But he talks about here that after the events of Rocky V, Rocky lived in a somewhat normal life, so nothing really exceptional happened, no real stress or strenuous activities. In the previous part of the email, he just explained how all the crap that he went through, and he's still functioning as a wrestler today. So it's very possible that Rocky, in the Rocky world, 20 years after the events of Rocky Part 5 to 6 or whatever it was, 16 years, that his head was okay. It wasn't as bad as they anticipated. Anyways, guys, thank you so much for the amazing show and for the grunting. Remember, we grunted for him. And he wanted to say that.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. He said maybe macho talk wasn't the right phrase. Guy talk is better. So that's what he meant to say, was guy talk. Okay. Thanks for the guy talk and keeping me in the gym mode, even though I'm outside on my front porch grunting along with you, Hector. Hector's awesome. I love him. I truly do. He seems like a really nice guy and wish him all the success and safety in his wrestling career. This is from Ibrahim Clayton. Goes, hi, Ryan and Kyle. I hope you and your families are keeping safe and well during these turbulent times. My name is Ibrahim, so I think this is his first time emailing us. I live in Glasgow, Scotland, and I'm a huge fan of Going the Distance podcast.
Thanks.
Firstly, I want to say a big thank you. I discovered the podcast early on in lockdown, and it's been a total lifesaver. I've enjoyed binge listening seasons 1 through 6, and also enjoyed the crossover episodes with Slycast. I love Rocky and the Rocky films. I was born in 76, so like you, Ryan, have grown up with the franchise. The films are such a big part of my life, and I'm fortunate that my wife feels the same way, so we are able to enjoy them together. It goes here, as hosts, you are a great combination. You have the perfect balance of humor and insight. I think I provide the humor, Kyle provides the insight. No, I'm joking. Like I said, in my UK Apple Podcast review, 5 stars of course, you guys really get Rocky. You get the sincerity, the heart, the characters, and the genius of it. But you also get the bonkerness of it. The sentient robots, infuriating continuity, and Stallone's at times bizarre naming conventions. I love the skits you guys do using scenes from the movies. They really crack me up. For me, it's okay for people that love Rocky to poke a little fun at it. I think that's natural and healthy.
Good. Good. I'm glad. Because I always get worried that I offend people and I make fun of stuff.
No, I think people know that we love the show. We love the series. It's like you can make fun of your family, but I can't make fun of your family.
Yeah, I get it.
Ryan, your interviews have been superb. Well, yeah, of course. Thank you. That's very kind. Highlights being, of course, Bill Conti and the Richard Gant episodes. Really wonderful stuff. Regarding the future of the podcast, post-Rocky Balboa, I'm really pleased you're doing the Creed films. Here we are. I hope they have a similar effect on people that your Rocky V season had on me.
I really struggle with part 5, but listening through your commentary gave me a deeper appreciation for parts of it. Maybe people that don't enjoy the Creed films will gain a new perspective through your in-depth analysis. Or maybe your Creed commentary will bring in new listeners to the podcast who have never watched the other Rocky films and bring them into the full Rocky universe. That's a great idea. I do hope you take the time with the Creed films that you have with the other Rocky films. I think it would be a shame to skirt over them. I feel the main issue with them is the likability of Adonis Creed. Or lack of likability. Yeah. He seems cool, which is fine, but cool sort of misses the point of Rocky. We love Rocky because he's not cool. He's an open book. I suppose the filmmakers would argue that they didn't want to just redo Rocky, but I do think that if the franchise is to move on without Stallone, then they need to make Adonis more of an everyman. He attached two pictures of him on the Rocky steps this time last year. He says he found it a really emotional experience and felt quite overwhelmed. Also, he says, I think he may have bumped into Mike Kunda before I'd actually heard of Mike Kunda. While I was there on the steps, a group of Brits asked me to take a picture of them and their Rocky tour guy. Well, that's hilarious.
That's for sure him, yeah.
That's funny. He didn't know at the time who Kunda was. He found out about Kunda after listening to the podcast. That's funny. He was driving them around in a black truck, yeah, and dressed in classic Rocky attire. I had a quick chat with him, and he seemed like a great guy. Anyway, that's enough of me. I could go on forever. Would love to hear you guys redo the films again in the future. I don't know about that. Also, would love for you to do a special episode on Tony Duke. For me, he's the unsung hero of the Rocky franchise, a total legend.
I'd be down for that.
That'd be interesting. Yeah, we could.
I don't know about a whole episode, but I think we could even do an episode for like secondary characters in the Rocky films, underappreciated characters, and he'd be like number one.
Yeah. Also looking forward to the Bloodsport episode, which was released since the reading of this email. It's on our feed now. That was a lot of fun, by the way, doing that with you.
Yeah, that was fun.
He rewatched the movie last night for the first time in maybe 30 years. So stay safe, he says. It's not quite the film I remember loving as a 12-year-old.
Yeah, I know exactly what he means when he says that.
He goes, he'll be especially interested to hear Kyle's thoughts as a newbie to the movie, which I guess by now he's heard. So I hope you enjoyed that, Ibrahim. And Ibrahim, thank you for that great email. That was really kind of you. But nice to hear from a new listener. That's awesome. This is from Patrick Mentel. He's emailed us before. It's Patrick again from Germany, Ryan and Kyle. Still an avid listener. Well, thank you to your podcast every week and still enjoying it a lot every time. The second part of my mail definitely fits better in the first Creed episode, but I'll start with Rocky Balboa. Just listened to the final episode of Season 6 and wanted to comment on a question that was asked on your Facebook page regarding the scene after the fight when Rocky walks out of the arena. I do firmly believe that the moment when Pauly turns Rocky around and he waves to the audience and pointing his finger towards the sky, it was really Stallone himself being so happy about the reaction of the live audience and about the fact that his dream to shoot one final Rocky movie was becoming a reality as it was at the very beginning of filming. It was shot right after the Bernard Hopkins versus Jermaine Taylor fight on December 3rd, 2005. That scene is among my favorite in all the Rockies. And I think that too. I think when Stallone does the, you know, waving to the crowd, it's...
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. What does your wife want? Tell her to go away.
Yeah. Sorry, we have one computer mouse.
Oh.
On her laptop, the touchpad stopped working for some reason, so she came down to steal the mouse.
Oh, that's fine. Only our patrons would see her, so she's allowed to, yeah. Throw an extra $5, she'll disrobe. He goes on to say, looking very much forward to your Creed coverage. I think that the time around the release of the film up to the Academy Awards ceremony for me was one of the most exciting as a Stallone and Rocky fan. I remember that, too. I remember being very excited for Stallone's Oscar nomination for Creed. He goes on to say, I was very reluctant when hearing that Sly is doing another Rocky, as the ending of Rocky Balboa was so perfect, but the trailers were great, the buzz around the film, sorry about Creed here, the buzz around the film and Sly's performance was huge, and when I saw the film, I was blown away. It instantly became my second favorite movie of all time, right behind Rocky Balboa. So he likes Rocky Balboa first, and then Creed Part 1. Yeah. All the nominations and Sly's Golden Globe win made this time around for Creed such a great experience. I'll for sure will write some more emails over the coming episodes. And who knows, Ryan, maybe you'll appreciate Creed more when watching it again for the podcast. It worked with Rocky V, didn't it? All the best to both of you and keep pod punching, Patrick, our German listener.
Thanks, Patrick.
Yeah.
It's impressive that he writes like as well as I do. English is not his first language.
Well, speaking of English not being his first language, other Greg wrote us.
Ah, yes. Oh, poor Greg.
Greg, the other Greg, he gave us an email. He just said here, it was a joy to listen to the season finale with you and Kyle and Ruben and your spirited guests. Congrats on another... Now, he's one of our patrons, so it doesn't really make sense.
Maybe he'll be on one.
Yeah, I think if he wants to. So, at the time of this recording, the episode, the season finale hasn't been released. So there you go, patrons. He's that early. There's the advantage. He's that early to listening to the episode that he can actually email us in time for a new recording. There you go. Okay. Anyways, he goes on to say, congrats on another terrific season. Looking forward to Creed and to Rambo. He tells us his height. Remember we asked for his height?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
He goes, I'm 6'4".
Okay. Yeah, that makes sense. Yeah. I think we figured it was around that height.
If I remember correctly, you guessed 6'2", and I guessed 6'1". So you were closer. Okay. You win. What you win, I don't know. Bragging rights. He says that Bert is not a very tall man, but he has a big presence. I think he's saying he's fat, because he did a winky face. I could be wrong. English isn't his first language, so maybe I'm reading the humor wrong. God. He goes on to say that Antonio Tarver was at the same gallery event as a guest of Bert. Mm. He said that Tarver was a gem, friendly and approachable. And he thinks Tarver is about 6'2 or 6'3. He doesn't seem overly imposing, but somehow you know he could decimate you if he chose to do so. Sure.
You ever wonder, like, if you see someone, you might think to yourself, could I beat that person in a fight or something like that? Right. I don't always think that, but I sometimes think that. I wonder what it's like when you fight as your full-time job, and then you can walk down the street and almost everyone you run into, you could beat the living shit out of.
Like, yeah,
that must be very empowering.
Well, guys, like,
but then there's also Tyson, like the equalizer, that you never know if they have a gun or something like that. Don't punch you through what matters at that point, but still.
Most people don't carry a weapon. Like, most don't carry a gun on any given day that you run into. So maybe I'm thinking as a Canadian, but yeah, imagine being so strong and powerful in a fight that you just carry yourself in a way that, okay, when push comes to shove, I'm going to be able to throw a couple punches regardless.
Like you said, Mike Tyson, but him or Tarver or anyone, like, they only take one or two.
Oh, well, that's the thing.
You don't even know what's coming.
They know how to connect. You see a lot of these YouTube videos of guys getting into fights. It's a lot of wild haymaker type swings, you know?
Oh, yeah, for sure.
And it's not, like, I'm not a fighter. This is me speaking as a non-fighter, but only as somebody who's seen fights. And you can tell those who kind of know how to throw and connect a punch, vice those who just flail their arms around. Yeah, a boxer, he knows how to connect in a very short distance and very quickly.
Yeah, and he knows how to slip or block whatever bullshit punch you try to throw, right?
Yeah.
Like those big haymaker ones. Like, you can see those from a mile away.
If you're a trained fighter in the karate, or like yourself, or you can see the punch coming. And like you said, slip the jab. Well, yeah, I can slip the jab, and I can also slip that haymaker coming a mile away.
You gotta move side to side, you know?
All right, so that's all the emails. So again, if you want to send us an email and have it read on the show and get a little shout out, that is gtdwithrr@gmail.com. Keep those tweets coming. Appreciate the support on Twitter. A lot of great fans, listeners on Twitter engaging the show. Appreciate that. Appreciate it. Also on Facebook, we get great responses. Basically, guys, on Facebook and Twitter, you guys have been amazing supporting the show, sharing it, talking about it. It really does help. It does help because people in your feed sees that, you know? So it's a way of promoting the show without doing much, just by saying, hey, great episode, good interview. And people will see that you've commented, like, oh, what are they talking about? Oh, they're talking about Rocky. Oh, I think we disconnected. It's okay, guys. I don't know what happened. The internet just dropped. It's weird. It's spooky. We'll get Kyle back here. This is the biggest blunder in Going the Distance history. Thankfully, we didn't have, like, a major guest on or something.
Hey.
This all wasn't your fault to begin with, number one. I don't know what happened. I think my internet dropped. Just dropped. I don't know what's going on. I actually have good internet, believe it or not, but...
Everyone being inside and stuff, it's the bandwidth is really challenged.
Maybe. It's all good. We're about to start, actually, talking about Creed. I actually forgot where we left off when that dropped, to be honest with you.
Who knows? Let's just start with Creed.
Okay. So Creed came out in 2015. We've talked about this throughout our whole, you know, we have six seasons of talking about Creed, in that I remember really briefly, if someone's listening to this episode and they haven't listened to the other six seasons, and this is Ryan talking. Hi, welcome to Going the Distance. I admit, when Creed was first announced, I was skeptical. In fact, I was embarrassed a little bit that Stallone was digging this well again. I was nervous. When you first heard Creed was announced, were you nervous or were you just excited?
Confused. It's like, he's dead. Creed movies, is this a prequel? What is this?
Yeah, that's fair. Yeah, Apollo's dead.
It's I didn't really look into it either. I don't know. I like Apollo Creed. I've always been an Apollo kind of fan. I've never disliked Apollo.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to see this shit. I was excited. I'm like, get a chance to see the Rocky universe again. I didn't have super high expectations for it. I wasn't like, oh, this is going to ruin the Rocky legacy, or this is going to be the best film ever. I was just kind of like, well, we'll see what happens. And I really liked it, so it worked out.
I'm excited. I am excited. Believe it or not, I think Patrick Mantel and, well, a couple of the emails we read, I'm sorry, I can't remember who either, but they mentioned that maybe, Ryan, you'll like the Creeds more. I like the Creeds. I love the Creeds. But what I love about the Creed films is Rocky. Stallone's performance is incredible, and I love his performances in the Creed films. Likeability of Adonis is kind of the issue. The likability. You know, we love Rocky. We love his pure heart, his kindness, his even his dopiness.
Yeah, I agree. Well, like, Rocky's the best. Of course. And he made that movie what it is. Michael B. was not dislikable, I don't think, but he wasn't endearing either.
That's the word, endearing. I like that.
The problem is the well's a bit poisoned from the start, because you have this seasoned, beloved character in the film, but then you come in supposedly as the main character, and you're supposed to outshine this person? Good luck with that. It's very hard to establish yourself. Essentially a Rocky series. Like, there can be debates all day long whether Creed counts as part of the Rocky series, but it's in the Rocky universe. You can't dispute that. You're going to walk in there and you think you're going to be more likable than Rocky. Like, it's not going to happen. You know, you're going to be overshadowed every time.
It's like saying the Captain America films, they're not Avenger films, but they're part of the Marvel universe.
Sure.
The Creed films are not Rocky films, but they're part of the Rocky universe. I know people call it Rocky 7, Rocky 8, Creed's 1 and 2, but now we can kind of really say it really is Creed 1 and 2, and it might eventually be a Creed 3, so they really are its own franchise. We're going to kick it off right away, do the first couple scenes of, Creed Part 1, or Creed. We're going to see, obviously, young Adonis fighting. That's coming up. That's the character Adonis, his young child. The question I ask, why did it have to be Apollo stepping out on his woman to have this child? We know that he had a son and a daughter from Rocky II. Yeah. They were running around doing shenanigans, and Marianne Cree was like, why don't you play with your kids? You know, your kids need you. They want to hang out with you. So we know that he had a son. It could easily just been argued that their child was raised in neglect. His father died in the ring. And all the emotion, he could still have been in juvie. He could still have been in trouble with the law. He could still have all these things. Now you say, well, Ryan is age. But then I go, okay, let's pretend that Marianne Creed was pregnant during the fight of Rocky IV. She was carrying a child. And so the age still would have lined up. All the feelings of anger, and I just want to be the, you know, baby Creed and the shadow of my father. If you were to tell me that this was Creed's son, if I missed like the first 15 minutes of the film, let's say, let's just pretend, and then you're like, hey, who's this guy? Well, it's Creed's son. You could watch the whole movie thinking it's Creed's son. There's very little has to do with the fact that he stepped out.
I'll say this, you could do it that way. That's an option. It would make sense. It would probably work to some degree, but I prefer the way it is in the movie because it gives you more room for character development. Because we have this guy, he's born, and he's the bastard love child that no one wants, essentially. That sounds very mean. I don't mean to sound bad like that.
Well,
he has to find his identity. I know he gets taken in by Marianne Creed. That would mess with your head. And a big part of Adonis's character arc is dealing with his demons inside, him trying to find his identity of who he really is. Who is this guy, Apollo Creed, right? He was, yes, brought into the Creed home, but he was already aged quite a bit by then. And he found that out as all of a sudden, like, you're 10, you find out your dad's like this Muhammad Ali, basically. That's a mind f- that gives you lots of room for the character arc. And it also gives an interesting perspective for his relationship with Marianne. Because imagine if you're her, you take this kid in, and you realize it's not the kid's fault that he exists. He had nothing to do with the infidelity, but that kid's a reminder that your husband cheated on you. That adds a dynamic to their relationship and some of the tension between them sometimes. And I like it better. It gives more room. It basically gives Adonis, the troubled person persona, more. It gives him an obstacle to overcome, and every character needs that. I'm cool with it. Apollo does seem like a guy who would bang another woman, so, like, he's based on Muhammad Ali, and he did that, so, like...
Yeah, we'll blame Muhammad Ali for Apollo's infidelity.
Yeah.
But if Muhammad Ali can do it, so can Apollo. I could play devil's advocate a little bit and say, well, a smart writer could still write some sort of angst that would work in the film without having the issue of infidelity. But Yeah.
Also, she wasn't pregnant noticeably in the film.
Yeah.
And of course, you could write in, well, she wasn't showing or whatever. But then it's like, you're going to know that as someone who watched the film before.
Well, you're retconning it either way. You're telling us that Apollo, just moments before dancing to Living in America, he slept with one of the showgirls, or Marianne's pregnant from a month before. Well, that's why he lost the fight. Woman, weakened legs. He was
super... Yeah, exactly. So it was your fault, Adonis.
All right, here we go. Opening credits. Creed, 2015. Directed by Ryan Coogler. And I guess we should say, I can't imagine anyone that doesn't know. We're not going to get too far in the weeds here of how the movie was made. But my understanding was Ryan Coogler's father was a huge Rocky fan.
Yeah.
And he was dying of cancer, maybe, or some sort of sickness. They watched Rocky together. We can get into that stuff even later. It doesn't have to be done today. But he's only 34 right now. And this came out 5 years ago. So he was about, I think he was 27 or 28 when he approached Sly with the Creed script. And he, to Coogler's credit, he really kind of said, look, please, Mr. Stallone, read this script. And I think it wasn't until Stallone saw or heard about Fruitvale Nation that he decided to read the script. Which is understandable. Can you imagine how many scripts are probably just thrown Stallone's way? Like,
oh, who knows?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's probably a ton.
Mr. Coogler would have been very young. I mean, like 27 in Hollywood is like baby years. Even younger than Stallone was when he did Rocky.
I'd be curious how many people pitched, well, I'll say Rocky-esque sequels to Sly over the decades.
Oh, maybe, yeah.
I'd love to know that one, because it's not zero.
So, Coogler's dad suffered from a neuromuscular disorder, and they watched the Rocky films together.
Rocky 2 was the favorite.
Yeah, that's weird. But yeah, Rocky 2 was their favorite that they watched together. So inspired by his father and his love of films, love of the Rocky films, he said, you know what? I can continue the story. And let's just be honest, give it an African-American or black spin. We're gonna focus it on the Apollo lineage. I mean, we know that Ryan Coogler is obviously, that's what his movies are about. He is like a young Spike Lee. But talk about race, the problems of race in society. Fulfilled Nation covered that, Creed covers that, and even the Black Panther film covers that. So to his credit, he keeps that theme in his films, and Creed was no different. That's the Coogler connection. So here we go. We'll start the movie. Here we go. You ready?
I'm ready.
So the movie opens with Los Angeles, California, 1998. So this would have been 8 years after the events of Rocky V, correct?
Yes, Rocky V. That's right. I was thinking Rocky IV, like basically when Adonis is born-ish. Did Adonis be born in 86? Since his...
I can't...
Apollo would have conceived him in 85, right?
I think in the movie... This is one of those weird things where I think Michael B. Jordan is close to 30-ish in the film Creed. But his character, I think he's like 8 or 9 in the opening scene here. And then the events of Creed... present time is 17 years later, so we're probably led to believe he's 26-7 in, you know, 25 to 27 in the current day of Creed Part 1.
Michael B's real age, he was born in 87. I thought he was older.
So if he's born in 87, if you're to use the character and the actors being the same age, that makes sense. He looks about 10 or 11 in this film. You know, the character of Adonis at the beginning.
Yeah. I'm trying to see if they give a birthday for Adonis Creed. I don't think they do.
They don't
do.
Really, no.
This piqued my interest right away, being in... Oh, it says he was born June
1, 1986. Okay. So he's 12.
I don't know who decided that. I don't know how legitimate that is, because this is Wikipedia I'm looking up on, but...
Maybe a novelization of the film.
This piqued my interest because I was born in 84.
Hmm.
I was a teenager in 1998. I'm like, this is my time. Like, I was a youth at that time too. So it's someone that age watching the film that makes you just kind of relate to it just a little bit more.
Sure. They made it work. Adonis is 12 or 11 in the opening sequence here. That would mean 17 years later, he's 28. And I think Michael B. Jordan was...
Yeah, he's 12.
Yeah, so he was 28, 29 during the events of Creed. So Adonis and the actor, Michael B. Jordan, were the same age. They got the actors playing the same age as the characters at the start of these franchises, which is a good idea.
Pretty close in age. I like that.
Same
like
age as Rocky.
And it's funny because a lot of films, you have people in high schools and stuff that are like actually like 22.
Right, yeah, easily. 22 is even young. The guy up is 25, 26. I just did an episode on my Worst of the Best podcast. Check it out. We did Spider-Man. Go back and check it out. Spider-Man. And we talked about Tobey Maguire, for example. He was 27 playing a high school student for part one.
Yeah, man. 27 high school student.
Yeah. And then Andrew Garfield was 30 or 31 when he did part one of his Amazing Spider-Man, when he took over the role.
That's like Sarah Hyland on Modern Family. Looks like an actual teenager.
Yeah, still does.
But was in fact an adult. Yeah.
She still looks the same age. She might have some sort of weird growth disorder, because she looks the same age after 11 seasons. Okay, so here we go. We're in the Los Angeles Youth Correction Facility.
I don't know why, but there's something I find fascinating about prison. I always watch like Scared Straight shit or Locked Up or whatever. Never been to jail. I don't ever want to go to jail, but I find it interesting. Very curious what goes on in jail. So as soon as I see like, ooh, this is like a jail, I'm like, oh, this is interesting.
Where's this go? Come on, tighten up. Single file, gentlemen. Center of the hall. Come on, tighten it up. Condition unit one, copy that, on the ground. Show me hands, let's go.
So we got a real different opening right away for a Rocky film. You know, we have a youth correctional facility. We have a prison guard handling the youth. There's an alarm that just went off. Probably a fight has just broken out, obviously. So the youth that this guy's walking with, you know, they have a drill. Like, when the alarm goes off and the guards have to take care of a fight, everyone else is not a part of the fight, puts their hands up in the air, puts themselves against the wall. So they're, you know, not going to get going on the rioting or fighting in the prison.
And it lets you know right away what kind of place this is.
Yeah.
This isn't some group home with some therapy or something. They're treating these kids like they're in a maximum security prison.
Yeah.
This guy was pretty militant. It's pretty strict. And from what I hear, juvenile facility guard zoos in terms of fighting and sexual assault and everything. I've heard people say it's worse than the adult prison. I don't know if that's actually true or not, but I can see that. Just because teenagers are nuts.
Well, you know who likes the zoo?
Yeah.
So I remember watching this, and even right now, it's child-on-child fighting. You got a 12-year-old punch another 12-year-old in the face. It's pretty brutal hits to the face.
Yeah, that's kind of thing when kids fight. I remember that from junior high, people getting in fights. Is they're not that strong yet, so they can they can really punch each other in the face a lot without causing extreme injury, right? Because, like, if you really punch someone as an adult, you can break bones, right?
Sure. But yeah, it was a very strong opening, a very visceral, violent opening of child-on-child violence. And we see a very young, angry Adonis. And he's been pulled off his assailant. He's angry. Whatever they were fighting about, it's never stated or said, I don't think. Maybe it was. I can't remember. But yeah, he's going to go to solitary confinement right after this.
Hey, let him go! At least let me get my shoes.
Right away, we see, did it again. What is going on here? Okay, so sorry guys, I have no idea why my internet's doing this. Well, that was quicker. If that happens again, yeah, just re-click on the link. I did it from the email that I sent you, I re-clicked on the link. So I have no idea what is going on. This is weird that this happened with the internet today, no idea.
Satan doesn't want us to do this podcast.
Well, he's gonna have his wish. We're not gonna be much longer. We're just gonna do the opening sequence with the widow. We're about to get to it, so I just feel bad because I don't know why. Anyways, it's not
our shit happened.
All right. I don't want to shorten our episode because of these issues either, so...
We can always splice it into another episode or something, too, maybe? I don't know.
It's fine. All right, so Adonis has been taken away. We'll see that he's by himself, but time has passed. He was in solitary confinement. He's pulled away for the safety of himself and for the other inmates.
And to be punished, probably.
Yeah, combination of everything. Yeah, punishment. So we have an individual signing in. All visitors, please sign in, and we, of course, will find out. It's cool how they do the reveal. I think we all knew when we watched the film who it was, but it's not done right away of who she is. We see a mature, older lady coming to see Adonis, and of course, Adonis doesn't know who she is, so he just thinks she's another social worker, care worker, but we'll play that out. It's, of course, Marianne Creed.
I like her. I think she was very well cast in this role.
Totally agree. We're talking about, of course, Felicia Rashad. None other than Mrs. Cosby. She supported Bill's behavior throughout the years.
What the? No, she did. I don't know if she. I doubt she knew anything.
She was in on all the.
Man, she might have slipped a few. You know what I mean? Like, she might have had some close calls, unfortunately.
I'm sure she was completely unaware, and she's probably absolutely mortified. I feel bad for her that her own image, and through no fault of her own, is be kind of tarnished.
Yeah, because she's known as a Cosby, right?
Yeah, it sucks that her own image is tarnished, that she's Mrs. Cosby for whatever, nine seasons on TV. Mm-hmm. Okay, but she looks fantastic. She hasn't aged a day, it seems like. I mean, she looks older, but she doesn't look old. It's hard to explain, but she's aged very well.
Yeah, she's aged gracefully.
She is currently 72. She's only a couple years younger than Sly.
She would have been in her late 60s when this was filmed.
Well, this was filmed 5 years ago. She would have been, yes, 67.
67. She's 66, 67, depending on when exactly it was actually filmed.
Nice, she looks great.
Oh, really good. Yeah.
And her acting is always spot on.
Oh, yeah. No, she's excellent.
So one of the workers in the correction facility actually dresses her right away as Marianne. An astute Rocky fan who might have been unaware of who she is would know right away, oh, this is Marianne Creed.
I would like to know what it would take for Marianne Creed to get involved in this situation at all. She's not related to Adonis at all. Obviously, she was married to his biological father. Do the corrections people know that Apollo Creed's his dad? Did anyone in the public actually know that?
Yeah, that's a great question. Great observation. I don't know how she knew. We know that she is a woman of resources and money. My only guess is that the mother... Oh, he might have only been in the facility a short time, and that the mother abandoned him, or she was incapable of taking care of Adonis. For all we know, maybe she went to Marianne. So just so you know, I can't take care of your late husband's son.
Later on, we learn that the family tried to cover it up. So, like, we know Marianne knows. In any situation, this woman, whoever Adonis's mom is, would have come after Creed's estate hard for cash. Child support cash.
And we don't need that kind of woman in our life.
Oh, no, you do not. My guess is she has very high-priced lawyers, people of influence and means that can kind of make stuff like this happen. Any normal person probably couldn't just, like, bud their way into someone's life like this and basically just adopt them. Like, I think you have to be connected to do stuff like that.
See, here's the thing. I don't think she would have, because it's not Marianne's style, especially because she's now, we're going to find out that she's going to take this boy on full time. I don't see her not helping Adonis's mom. I think Adonis's mom is probably a troubled individual. And I don't think we'll ever find out how she found out that Adonis existed. Because I don't see her saying, no, you stay away from my husband's money. Or maybe she did. Maybe she had a change of heart. Who knows? But the mother, as we know, must be out of the picture, either dead or in jail, that she's able to fully adopt Adonis.
And this social worker's legs are 400 feet long. She's basically a giraffe.
I love how they're both women are wearing high heels, too.
I don't mean to objectify her.
No, you're not. Really not objectifying. You're just saying that her legs are long. She's wearing a long slack pant. They are very long.
Adonis got into a fight today, and he's in holding. If you want to see him, we're going to have to go up there.
I hate to say it, but this is what we do on the show. This is a little bit of bad writing, because the way she says it, she goes, Adonis got in trouble today. He got into a fight. He's in solitary or whatever he's in holding. So it sounds like their conversation's familiar about who Adonis is, but Adonis doesn't know who Marianne is.
Yeah, I never thought of that, but that's true.
Because the conversation should have been, Marianne, welcome to this facility. Thank you for taking your time to come here. Came at a time when Adonis, who you're about to meet for the first time, just got into a fight. Just so you know, he just got into a fight. I know I'm spelling it out, but the conversation, Marianne seems very familiar with who Adonis is, but Adonis has no idea who Marianne is.
I'll be the apologist here.
Sure.
I'll be the apologist. By the way, they give a good point here. But from the apologist, what I'm going to say is, look, likely Marianne has been working with this person for a while to make this happen. In doing so, they became familiar and built a rapport, therefore using the first names. Marianne's probably been really looking forward to and anticipating this meeting for quite some time. She's probably envisioning it being in, like, a visiting room or somewhere nice or something like that. And then the day she happens to come, is the day Adonis gets in a fight with some kid and is not allowed there, and he's in solitary, and it's this whole thing up. And she seems like nervous to tell her that, like they screwed up or something. But I think she's nervous that this person's of means here is disappointed. But that's my alternative theory.
The movie so far is, it's not clear. It's not clear how much she knows or how much they've talked before this moment. So
I liked this as a first-time viewer, by the way. Like, I loved not knowing, like, what is going on? Who is this? That's Mrs. Creed, but is it her son in jail? What the hell is happening?
Right.
And then it's like, well, she's kind of a little old to have a son who's, like, 10.
Well, he was 12. She's 67.
Yeah, so she would have been 55. That's old to have a kid, right?
But like, then, that's. But how old was Apollo when he died?
Well, they're probably a similar age, but he's probably banging away younger women, right?
Yeah.
Like, well, he was probably like 25 or something.
So she was 55 when Adonis was born. We have to assume Apollo was pushing 50 to 55 as well. So when he fought Drago, was he 50?
Okay, Apollo Creed, we can find his age. I think he was in his 40s.
This is, again, where the Rocky continuity is all over the place. And I know we're using Marianne's real age, but we kind of have to, yeah. because they do say it's 17 years later for 2015. They tell us this is 1998. So we know Creed, we must have a date of Creed.
I think he's born in like 46 or something. He's a baby boomer for sure. He's born in 48. He wasn't even 40 yet. When he fought Ivan Drago, he was 38.
This is ridiculous. So I guess we're using Miss Rashad's real age in the film. I guess we shouldn't be doing that.
She's a little old to be having a kid that young. Like, I guess it's technically possible, but it's not feasible. It's not probable.
Okay, so if Apollo was born in 48, he would have been...
She's probably born in the early 50s.
So we're led to believe right now here she's 50-ish.
Yeah.
Okay, because Apollo would have been 50 had he still been alive. Okay.
I can believe that's a 50-year-old. Okay. She looks great.
Yeah, I mean, then she looks 50. A good 50 here. I mean, she's 67 as an actress, but that's where we had to... I just had to make that clear. So she is 50 in the film. Okay. All right, let's continue. But actually, no, so she would be...
She's around 50. It depends when she's born. I'm guessing she's born in 1950, because usually women marry guys who are a couple years older.
Let's say she's 48... right now in this scene, 1998. But then, yeah, it makes sense. 17 years later, in Creed part, she'd be 67. So she would be the proper age, the actress, when it's time jumps 17 years. There you go. Oh, there you go. So it works out. Perfect.
All right. Plus, like, she doesn't look that much older when they show Adonis all grown up, right?
Yeah.
He's a good kid. He just fights all the time.
So, of course, he just fights all the time, and you can see her face like, ugh. I know somebody else who fought all the time.
I wonder what her kids were like.
That's one of the flaws in these films. They never talk about it. There's never a meeting between Adonis and his half-siblings. It's really weird.
What are you talking about? The guy at the gym's his half-sibling.
No, that's Tony's son.
No, it's not.
Yes, it is. That's Tony Duke's son.
Is it?
Yes.
That makes sense. Because I'm like, why is this guy... Okay, that makes more sense now. Because the way they were talking, it was they were family.
Well, yeah, the same way Apollo and Rocky were family.
Oh, God, that's like takes a split. I was going to complain about that later in the movie. I'm like, I don't believe this guy with f***ed up teeth and talking like that is like Apollo's son that grew up in mansions and shit.
No, it's Tony Duke's son.
Oh.
And they mention it in Creed 2 when they look at the picture of him in the office about their two dads. There's a quick scene that Adonis and I forget his name, the character's name. We'll get to it. He has a bigger role in Creed 2. But they grew up together because, of course, Tony and Apollo's families have always been close. So that's how they knew each other growing up. Mm. See, okay, whoa, boy. Okay, Tony was alive in 2006. Apollo died in 1985. Adonis was adopted in 1998. Tony's kid and Adonis were friends. They grew up together, but somehow Adonis and Rocky never met. And
they grew up together?
Yes, they talk about that in the scene. They talked about, there's a reference to their youth in the scene in that ring, when he goes into the ring at the gym to fight people.
Yes, but I thought that was after Marianne took him in.
That's what I'm getting at. So when Marianne adopted Adonis in 1998, Tony was still friends with the Creed family. And Tony was still friends with Rocky. Somehow Adonis never met Rocky until the restaurant scene.
Well, probably they told Tony to keep his mouth shut because they don't want it well known that... Because she doesn't like Rocky that much, so she's not going to trust him. So she probably says, hey, look, Tony, I'd appreciate if you do me a solid and keep this on the down low.
Yeah, absolutely. That's kind of what's interesting is what I'm saying is, yeah, Tony, during the events of Rocky Balboa...
Oh, yeah, yeah.
...knew about Adonis' son.
He had to. Unless he was like, la, la, la. I just didn't want to know, but...
yeah, that's just kind of blows my mind. That blows my mind a little bit. Okay.
I wonder if the Duke character was still alive for Creed 1. When did Tony... When did...
I think it was shortly before or after this film was made.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I did do a quick internet search, and you are right. That is Tony's son.
Yeah, so...
Which makes me feel so much better about this whole thing
now. Good. Yeah, so that's Tony's son. No, he died... The actor died a couple years before the release of this film. That's why I remember thinking he wasn't in it. Oh, okay. He wasn't alive to be in it.
Johnson.
Yeah.
Right this way. Johnson, got a visitor.
So, of course, they're referring to Adonis. His last name is Johnson. That's probably, of course, his mother's name.
Yeah.
Adonis. Come on in. I'd like you to meet Mrs.
Could we have a moment, please?
Sure.
It's a little bit of a writing trope because Marianne stops the worker from saying, I want you to meet Mrs. Creed. Now, it would be like saying, I want you to meet Mrs. Ali. There might have been like, oh, this is the former champion's widow. You know, even he might know this is a 12-year-old boy, who she is. I'm trying to think, this is Mrs., I don't know, Hollyfield, Evander Hollyfield or something. It might have been a big enough last name in this universe that if he heard the name
Creed. Well, it would have been.
Yeah.
Yeah, like Creed's basically, like Creed is Ali.
Yeah.
You'd be recognizable around the world. I think she doesn't want that part of the conversation to go there yet, and so she very gracefully stops her for just touching her arm like that. I thought that was great.
It's a great moment, but it's twofold. It did what we just said it did, but it also keeps it for the viewer in the movie who isn't too sure for the reveal. So when Adonis gets the reveal, so does the audience member who might not be privy to what's going on. We knew right away who she was, but there's still people who aren't fanatical about the Rocky franchise. Like, oh, that's Mrs. Creed. Because when she says, that's my husband. Your father's my husband.
My wife saw this movie with me, and she was not up on Rocky at all, so she didn't know. People like her, that's what that would be designed for.
That's what I mean. It's a two-fold thing. Her as a character is telling this worker, hey, I will let him know who I am in my own time. But it's also, hey, it'll be a fun little reveal for the audience during this little meeting. It's like a little reveal.
Yeah, and you didn't have to write it that way. You could have written it just like, we have a moment, please? Yeah, sure. And she walks up.
Right.
But I think it was nice that they kind of teased you a bit for the audience members. I thought it was okay writing. I had no problem.
Be right outside.
So right now for our listeners, Adonis is not looking at Marianne Creed, but she sits down about to talk to him.
Why were you fighting?
I'm not going to another group home.
I'm not from a group home.
You're a social worker.
No, I am not a social worker.
Can we stop here for a sec?
Of course.
I find her acting very interesting here.
Mm-hmm.
You can see that this is like very difficult conversation for her.
Mm-hmm.
Like this is painful for her to talk about. I think it's hard for her to look at him. I think she's very torn about him.
Yeah.
He is the product of her husband's infidelity. And this is why I think it's good that they went down the infidelity road because of this type of action.
Sure. It adds drama. I feel it here. It adds drama that this scene is all about the infidelity. This scene wouldn't exist without the infidelity. I got you.
I really liked her acting. How she wasn't just like, no, I'm not a social worker. I'm not a group home. She was just, I don't like having to explain who I am here. I don't like this situation.
Right. Okay. Yeah, she almost, I wouldn't say seems insulted, but she's like.
She does, yeah. I think you're right.
She seems a little like put off. Like, no, I'm not a social worker. Like, I am a well-to-do woman, and you are the product of my husband's cheating. So she is holding back a lot of, I almost want to hit you, not you as a child, but for what you remind what my husband did. Not only did he die in the ring, but he slept around. It's a really painful moment for her.
And also, her husband, of course, is deceased. If she sees his resemblance in him here, that's got to be weird.
Yeah.
For her, there's the real confluence of all these different conflicting emotions. Because on top of all that, too, she probably feels empathy for this kid's situation. Because this is generally not a place for children.
I will.
Like, it's this very horrible environment. It's not doing any favors to this kid. She probably feels very bad for him.
Whoever the barber is in this correction facility does incredible fades. Facility, that's a sharp haircut. Now, I know it's
obviously...
It could
be kid's hustle, right? He could be doing that for ramen noodles or whatever.
Yeah, that's a nice fade. All right.
Nigga said something about my mom, so I beat his ass.
There's the first N-word drop in a Rocky movie.
It was very subtle, too. It was like, eh.
Yeah. Yeah, it's common language for him.
Yeah. I'm glad they do that. Rocky has always been very clean in terms of language.
Well, Rocky, of course, would never say it. But the Rocky movies have black characters, but they've never dropped the N-bomb in any.
Well, they don't swear at all in Rocky. They don't say they don't say shit.
Mickey did.
Oh, did he?
Yes, in part one. It was during the apartment scene. And he also said the F-word, but they muted it. During that apartment scene when he came up to ask Rocky to manage.
All the shit that happens to me, yes, doesn't happen to you. So, but it's rare. It's like very rare that you hear even a shit. Yeah, you don't hear any fucks.
And there was a one GD as well.
Okay. It depends if you even count that as a swear.
GD8.
Yeah, generally pretty.
Yeah, yeah. No, that was
on the cursing.
That was it for. I think there might have been. Was there one in Rocky V?
I don't think so. I don't think there was in Rocky IV. No. I think the rest of the movies are pretty clean in terms of language.
Probably skirted it pretty close.
That's the one unrealistic thing. People in those environments swear a lot more. They left that out, and that's fine. But it's just that is one way it's not realistic.
I'm sorry about your mother. I know what it's like to lose someone.
So there you go. His mother is dead.
I thought so. But I thought maybe I was wrong. Guess not.
Of course, she referenced, I know what it's like to lose somebody because she's lost Apollo.
When your father died, I was angry for so long. I hurt myself, pushed family away.
I don't have no father.
So there you go. She's already starting to bring up Apollo. Interesting little drop. He's like, I've never met this lady before. And she's mentioning my father. When your father died, I hurt so much. I pushed people away, pushed
she's
family away.
She's talking as if he should know. Obviously, she knows he doesn't. But it's like she says it as if. She's kind of almost purposely dropping it in to make him think. Make him wonder what she's talking about. Like, it seems very calculated.
I think she's also just like a therapy session.
Mm-hmm.
Just dropping on this kid saying, hey, when your father died, it hurt me, and I pushed my family away. That could be where the other two kids are. She pushed them away. She says she pushed the family away.
Which would be f***ed up because it's their dad just died.
She says she was angry.
Yeah.
And when you're angry and when you're grieving, you can make, obviously, poor choices. I mean, doesn't mean they're not back with her now.
Yeah, there could have been a few years where things were like... Ugh.
And that would explain maybe at the time her separation between Rocky IV and the Creed films that her and Rocky weren't on speaking terms. But they are in Creed 2 on speaking terms. I like how they did mend their bridges. Though we never really see it happen, but we know it's been mended.
They're not mended in this film.
No.
That's one thing I liked about Creed 2 was watching them speak.
Well, she called him. Say, hey, can you help out Adonis? Yeah.
What did you say?
I said I don't have no father.
So right away, he says, I don't have a father. And in his mind, he doesn't. He's never met a dad. He doesn't know who his dad is. He's never been told. So she's already speaking to him like, take those words out of your mouth type thing. You do have a father. She's about to get
She's talking like a mom. She's asserting mommy-ness right now. Because maybe that's her instinct or whatever. Like,
what did you say?
I said I don't have no father.
That's not true. He passed before you were born, but you had a father.
You know
him? He was my husband. Adonis, I would like it very much if you would come and stay with me. Do you think you'd want to do that?
So there's a nice little scene there where his fists are clenched in anger or frustration, and as he's thinking about this, and she notices it, but his grip relaxes. He puts his guard down. It's a sign that he's put his guard down.
First, she did not drop the Creed name yet.
No.
He he does not know his dad's creed, because she could have sold that a lot better. She's like, you know, I live in this huge mansion. You have like a pool. And
hundreds of millions. She's worth hundreds of millions, at least. At least yeah. Anywhere, $50 to $150 million.
She's like a type of wealthy that you couldn't really understand as a normal person.
Yeah.
The sheer resources. So yeah, she undersold that. You saw what this environment was like at the beginning of the film, right? These people are not nice to the kids. Like, maybe that social worker is nice to them. This is a harsh environment. Probably a lot of these kids are legitimately violent, and it's like a f***ed up place. It's like, this is probably one of the very few instances in his life where he felt someone have compassion for him, and he felt someone want him, actually want him to be there, not like a group home or a foster person has to take him on.
Right.
Or a social worker that has to take him on. But this person's coming out of nowhere and says, I like you. I'm connected to you somehow family-wise. I want you to be with me. I would really like that. He's probably yearning for that sort of thing.
A creed. That's going to drop a lot these next two seasons. I'm sorry, but... Did you notice his eye?
Yeah, it's messed up from the fight, right?
Yeah.
He's busted! Oh, God.
Oh, that was a cheap shot. I couldn't help it. We're getting punchy here. Okay, we'll just finish the scene. So it looks like he's going to accept the offer.
What was his name?
Oh, there we go.
Great opening. I will say that's a pretty clever way to do it. He goes, what was his name? And then the title card comes on with that nice swell of music, Creed.
And you still don't know what happened. You just know, like, you can kind of put two and two together, mind you. But you just know that follow out a kid with someone.
We hear the first kind of theme or score of the film, and we should note that the composer of the film is this weird name, Ludwig Göransson. So he composed Creed 1 and 2, and he also did the Mandalorian soundtrack. Yeah. Okay, so there you go. There is episode 1, season 7 of our Creed coverage. I think we did it fair.
We're 5 minutes into the movie, and we've done an entire episode. So I don't think we're breezing through Creed.
No, we promise
we'll say.
We'll try to make the breaks natural. I think this is a natural one, of course, the intro, right up to the intro. The next episode will be, of course, Creed fighting in the ring. We get to see Adonis 17 years later fighting in Tijuana, Mexico. We'll talk about that, and we'll go from there, see how long that discussion goes. I want to thank again our new patrons and your support and the ones who continue to support and pledge the show. Thank you so much. It really means a lot and helps for the show to grow and for us to keep the feed alive and to expand it for the Rocky Minute and Slycast episodes. Also, if you want to follow us on Twitter, we've got to follow Twitter. Kyle.
Your brother, I followed him, but he hasn't followed me back.
Okay, you think you're bad at Twitter? Ruben's the worst.
Oh, okay. That makes you feel a little better.
No, yeah, he would never ghost you. He would never ghost you.
Yeah, I'm in the 30s now. No, actually, I have 29 followers. Oh, shit. I have another female
followers. I know. Yeah. Don't bury the lead. Yeah, we'll get to her. So your first new follower is a guy named DS.
He has Rocky in his picture, so I knew he was followed by Adrian, so I knew he was legit.
Yeah.
So I followed him back right away.
Yeah, so he follows you. Shout out to DS at King_DSS. And then, Julie W. This is weird. Who is she to you, Julie W.?
Oh, actually, no. That's like a person I believe that's who someone I know in real life.
I was going to say, because it's not followed by anyone I know or following.
So let me see your followers. Yeah, that's a real-life friend of mine.
Okay.
So I'm going to follow her back now.
I'll allow it. She won't listen to the show. And then
actually, she has listened, I think, once.
Oh, okay. Well, shout out to Julie W., her at Julie. That's actually how she writes it.
Okay. No, Julie's really cool.
Cool.
She's legit.
All right. So if you want to follow Kyle, do so on Twitter. Follow us on Facebook. Give us a review. We haven't had a review in a long. I will say, look, leaving a review is free. And it really does help us out. If you want to leave us a review, we'll read that out on the air. And we haven't had one in a while. Are you going to be the next one? Especially when now we're doing Creed. You can do that as your review. You can say, hey, these guys are now covering Creed. No other podcast has done the Creed coverage the way these guys have. So, uncharted territories. All right.
We're going to rename it Going the Distance, the Creed Series Podcast.
No.
Not.
No. No. That'd be terrible.
I just did that to troll you.
I appreciate that. Sorry. And I responded. I got caught. You baited me in and I got caught. All right, so again, we appreciate your kindness and patience as we make this show bi-monthly. I think that still, Kyle said that you guys would be okay with that, and I believe him, and I trust you guys, the listeners, that you will be understanding that, COVID vacation is over for Ryan, so...
I wanted to say this, and of course Ryan will edit this out. Okay. If you don't like it, you can go f*** yourselves.
Well, that's just it. I'm going to keep that in.
Goddamn podcast.
Yeah, if you don't like, if you think we should be doing more Rocky coverage at a more frequent pace, I should say, then guess what? Knock your socks off, create a podcast, and good luck, because we have paved.
You'll be busted.
Your podcast will be busted because there's no way that you can beat us. We're the best, and to be the best, you got to beat the best, and you got to go toe to toe.
We've retired more men than Social Security.
That's right.
Whatever that means.
And if you think you can start up, if you think you can't podcast, you might as well be dead, Stallion. I don't know.
Yeah, exactly.
We're going all over the place here.
Turn this podcast on and off like some damn radio. Actually, wait a minute. That's exactly what you can do to this. Never mind.
If you think you can create a Rocky podcast and beat ours, you can win.
You see what these guys can do?
You've read the reviews. Oh, I can't keep up. It's late. All right, brother. That's it. It's over. Take us out.
Ding, ding. Thank you.